And now, for something different. Well, maybe not completely different. Hi, hello, and welcome everyone to another episode of Natural Juan. This time around, we'll be discussing a creature known as the Ancient Enemy, found in the novel Phantoms by Dean Koontz. But before that, I'd like you all to subscribe to my channel and hit that bell for notifications if you want more content like this. Also, this video will contain a lot of spoilers for the novel and film, so if you haven't read the book or seen the movie but want to, I suggest you skip over this one. That is, unless you're one of those people who don't mind spoilers anyway. So, before we begin proper, let us first talk about the literature written by Dean Koontz. Dean Koontz is considered by some as a rival to Stephen King, as he too is well known for writing scary stories with often supernatural elements in them. Some even see him as a good alternative to Stephen King, but I see quite a difference in their tone and style of writing. For one thing, Dean Koontz leans heavily towards science fiction, such as time travel and the presence of aliens rather than magical or more esoteric menaces like Stephen King. At least, usually anyway, as Dean Koontz has written purely supernatural horror stories before. There's also the fact that Dean Koontz's work tend to be more optimistic than Stephen King's work, often ending with the heroes not just surviving, but also prospering despite their hardships arrayed against them. Dean Koontz is also quite adept at writing fight scenes, often being very descriptive of weapons used and how they are used in combat. Both authors have often been asked to collaborate before, but both have refused due to their incompatible themes and sense of storytelling. Anyway, the Ancient Enemy is the antagonist in the novel Phantoms. This novel is considered one of Dean Koontz's best novels and received high praise by many, including his literary rival Stephen King. It was so good, in fact, that it received a film adaptation in 1998 starring Ben Affleck and Rose McGowan. What truly made this novel quite memorable was its antagonist, the monster simply called the Ancient Enemy. After all, it is said that a story is only as good as its villain. And what a truly great villain the Ancient Enemy was. So what is the Ancient Enemy, you may ask? The Ancient Enemy is a terrible creature that has existed for millions upon millions of years. Its true form is that of a vast pool of biological matter, interspersed with its actual cells. This is what truly sets it apart from most monsters because, using its cells, it can command its surrounding biomass to take on various forms, such as when mimicking people and animals, or even the truly impossible, such as that of a giant insect or a demon. Not only that, it can also separate parts of itself, forming them into heralds of sorts to force prey towards itself, or even communicate with or attack potential victims, while the rest of it remains within a safe distance. Another of its interesting abilities is absorbing the memories of its victims and integrating them to itself. This last is what truly makes it a formidable beast, as it gains greater intelligence the more victims it devours. While not stated in the book outright, it is implied that not only did it outlive the dinosaurs, it might be responsible for their extinction in the first place. Various mass disappearances throughout human history are attributed to the Ancient Enemy. This includes mysterious disappearances such as the vanishing of the lost colony of Roanoke in the early beginnings of the United States, as well as the sudden loss of contact with a detachment of Japanese soldiers in China during World War II. The Ancient Enemy gains an uncanny resemblance to one of H.P. Lovecraft's godlike monsters, specifically Abhoth, who is essentially another pool of living matter who constantly spawns freakish horrors only to reabsorb them into its body. However, whereas Abhoth is mostly a neutral force and isn't actively malevolent, the same cannot be said for the Ancient Enemy. The latter is seething with nothing but contempt and malice towards humanity, as it clearly sees them as beneath it and are prey animals to feed on. It even considers itself as a kind of devil to mankind, thanks to absorbing the memories of humans it has devoured in the past, who probably attributed to it the concept of Satan and other mythological monsters, such as Proteus of Greek mythology. However, as the main characters later on discuss, it's quite possible that it only gained its intelligence thanks to man, and that it probably is just a dumb animal without the influence of man. In short, Humans were the ones who made it what it is today, rather than it actually influencing humans over the millennia. This can best be seen in its pettiness towards humans, and its utterly cruel nature that is more reminiscent of a child who likes to hurt animals, rather than the scheming mastermind an ancient eldritch horror is usually depicted as. That said, it is quite powerful as a monster, thanks to its amorphous flesh and ability to gain the memories of its victims. In the story proper, it was able to completely decimate the entire population of Snowfield in California almost overnight. When the local police force called on the US military to take on the creature, it annihilated them too, almost effortlessly, and survived only because the creature wanted them to. This is because it wanted them to contact an old researcher who has gotten an inkling of its nature, Dr. Timothy Flight. He intends to make Dr. Flight its disciple and tell the world of its godlike power, which again reveals more of its childishness, simply exterminating the military along with the protagonists and just leaving clues for Dr. Flight would have added more to its mystery and menace. Anyway, Dr. Flight, portrayed by none other than Peter O'Toole in the film, reveals the true nature of the ancient enemy. Despite all of its power and its claim to godhood, it is, at the end of the day, just an animal. And, to be more precise, an animal that can be killed. It takes the protagonists a while to plan its destruction, but after analyzing its cells and chemical composition, they learn that it is actually quite similar to that of crude oil. Or, at least close enough that they can use certain microorganisms designed to consume oil spills to fight the creature. At the end, the protagonists are able to fight back against the ancient enemy using the microorganisms, which start consuming the creature at an alarming speed. As the ancient enemy flees the scene, it realizes that it is doomed as the microorganisms are simply working too fast for it to effectively fight. Its last thoughts are that it has played right into the irony of the mythology it had helped create. It had been cast down and will spend its remaining time, which was an hour or more at best, cursing humanity whom have bested it and cast it down. After dealing with the incompetent cultists the ancient enemy acquired, the book ends on a happy and optimistic note. After all, the ancient enemy would not have been the menace it turned out to be if it did not absorb the memories of humanity. Also, whatever cruelty it might have acquired were also traits it gained from humans it devoured. That said, one must wonder if there was a way the ancient enemy could have survived after it was infected with oil-eating microbes. And an even bigger question is, was the creature alone? Isn't it possible that there were actually more like it hidden in the world? The last would be quite disturbing indeed, as it would imply that while the protagonists might be safe and happy, other communities in the world close to the sea are still in danger. So that's it for this episode of Natural Juan. I really hope you liked this particular episode, as I'll be doing more videos on the works of Dean Koontz as well as Stephen King. I'm also planning to do some work on Robert Jordan's Wheel of Time, a truly epic fantasy story due to both its scope and the sheer length and number of its volumes. That said, for all you TTRPG fans out there, don't worry. I'll still be doing plenty of videos about your favorite games, and some of the things I've lined up are the Iron Kingdoms RPG, Little Fears, and I'm going to follow up on the game of the Iron Claw RPG I've been doing. So if you'd like to see my future videos, feel free to subscribe to my channel and hit that bell for notifications. See you all in my next video.